Why should you go to headphones?
I have yes, you should go to headphones. I have pushed the streams. Let's see if they're streaming.
Are we here? We're streaming. Oh, look, I got to look. I'm going to look. Inquiring minds want to know. It's Tuesday night. Happy Valentine's, all. Are we live or are we Memorex?
We're live.
Are we?
Yes.
What are you looking at? Did you go Facebook too or no?
YouTube is live, and let me take a look at Facebook.
I think it's a waste of time now.
You say that.
Well, you know, it's funny because it used to be my kids would say, oh, you know, Facebook was ours, and then it was my parents, us. And now I think it's like my parents. Old school. Oh, we're live there, though.
Yep, we're live there. I'll pin that.
All the octogenarians. Hi, Facebook.
Yeah, only the old people show up on Facebook anymore. So you guys been following the balloon stuff? Out there in the general news, they're shooting down party balloons now. Apparently,
yeah, I saw that. I worry and wonder about how many real balloons that they could go on the web tracker that we looked at. I don't know, it was a week ago. Say, oh, you know, that's this balloon or that balloon. I think the first one that went over your house, it did have the death lasers on it, Gary. It wasn't.
That was real.
Yeah. I don't think any of the other things that I've seen so far, but I don't know. Just don't know.
Working on doing some trimming up stuff here on.
But we're live. Wirecast. Yeah. Let's see how many people. Five of us watching. That means you and me and Jim. Are you watching YouTube?
Yeah.
So that means us and two other people, Don and Don.
They'll get to us. They'll get there.
Oh, and Reggie Love.
Yeah, I didn't put a countdown or anything on here. We're just kind of randomly starting this show. I've got some things to show you guys. Listen to this. This is something that you have not heard before on your end of the stream.
It didn't work. Oh, I heard it.
Yeah. You didn't hear it last time because I didn't have original sound for musicians turned on.
I want to know, but none of the audience wants to know. Is that all in the Wirecast or it's all in the file?
It's Wirecast. It is.
So I have the right file already. I just don't have the capability.
Yeah. And I'm not sure you're going to get it because you have the studio version. Right? Yeah.
Nah.
And this is an advance made in the pro version.
Wirecast.
It lets me do some audio breakout things that I can now send this audio, which was always heard on the stream, but never heard on the Zoom. I can now put it on the Zoom. I can also put this on the Zoom, which will help a lot, I think.
I got some rest coming up too.
Yep. And then when I finally do this at the end of the show, you're going to hear it. And then right. You'll hear what you never hear, this click and the crackle, crackle, crackle stuff.
You heard the pop.
Yeah. So, yep. It's all very exciting stuff coming up. We're going to talk about Bouvet in a minute, but I got a couple other things I need to, I don't need to do anything. This is not a need to know thing. This is a want to share some stuff. I was on the phone with RT Systems. I guess earlier today, I've been having some issues with the programmer for my Anytone 578 and 878 radios. In specific, there's a function that was added to the 578 and the 878. These are DMR radios. DMR radios are based on zones. Mm-hmm. And you can have, I think the limit is 250 zones in the radio, and as you push a rocker button on the radio or on the mobile, you switch between the zones. But if you got a lot of zones set up, you might not want all of them presented to you all at once. Some of your zones may be for areas that you're not currently in. I have zones set up for the Raleigh area, zones set up for the Wilmington area where we vacation, zones set up for a couple other things around South Carolina. that I don't want, I'm not going to be using them routinely, so I don't want to have to step through them as I move from one zone to another. So they added a feature called Hide Zone. And when you do that, you don't step through them anymore. You can go to a menu and pick them out, go back and get them. But if you're just stepping through with the up-down step through the zone switch, you don't go through them anymore. But on the software, there was a column in the zone tab that would be called Hide Zone and a checkbox for each of those zones. You can say, make this a hidden zone or not. That column was not showing up on my desktop computer. It was showing up on my laptop computer that I use to carry programming down to the car and programming
That's
radios.
That's weird.
Yeah, but it was not showing up on the desktop. Now, I had a distractor. I had you know, Jim, you'll appreciate this, I think, from the usual troubleshooting techniques you think you found the issue based on the correlation of something, and it turns out to have nothing to do with it. The desktop computer was a Windows 10 computer. The laptop that I carry down to the car is a Windows 11 computer. And I'm thinking, ha, something about Windows 11 when making this work. And Windows 10 was not. Not true. I got to fix something on Jim's picture. You got a little black bar below you that doesn't belong there.
Jim's black bar.
I got to fix that. It's driving me crazy.
All right, I'm offended, Gary.
You're offended by the black bar?
No, I'm a troubleshooter.
Oh.
It's okay.
What's not happening right?
I've been shooting trouble for several decades. But I used to shoot trouble before there was a second one in the Windows 3.1. But whatever. Jim's smiling. Nope, and he's on mute too.
Let's see, you don't hear all those words that you don't want to hear.
Yeah. I want to hear the words.
I fixed your picture, but your chin is below the frame, so
he doesn't want to hear them.
That's okay, better.
I'll match Jim.
Okay, so it was. Yes, I'll go down here.
wait. Kill Rourke. My chair doesn't go down any further.
Yeah,
you do it this way.
So that wasn't the issue. What was the issue? Well, one of the things when we did the show with Karen at RT is she said the first thing you do with a radio when you're starting to use the RT system software is read the radio.
Yeah, you got to download a clean version of.
Whatever's in the radio. It picks up a lot of cues and parameters from reading the radio that won't sit in the software until you do that. Well, I had read the radio long time ago, back, you know, when unicorns populated the earth. I had read the radio, but I did a firmware update. The firmware update, one of the things in the firmware update was adding this zone hide or hide zone feature to the radio that hadn't been there before. And I did not read the radio after that. Now, my laptop computer that I carry down to the car, which is the way I program the radios, I transfer the files over to that and go down to the car and program it. And that has read the radio recently. I read back and forth. And so it had the hide zone column. But the desktop computer had not read the radio in a long time, so it never did. So I call them up, and I'm talking to them, and their tech on the phone. We go online, and she looks at my computer and she scratches her head and says, "Yeah, that's very mysterious. Can't figure out what's wrong." And so she gives it to the software programmer, and they called me back the next day and said, "Try reading the radio." So what I'm calling the desktop computer up here would be hard to carry down to the car, except it's not a desktop computer. It is a laptop computer. It just sits on the shelf, plugged into life support, power, Ethernet, HDMI to another monitor, keyboard, mouse, all that stuff. Like a dock, except there's not really a dock for it. So I unplugged it all, and I carried that computer down to the car, and I read the radio, and boom, now I got the hide zone column. Happy camper. I will say something about the software for the Anytone radio. They still have not gotten the ability to copy and paste. The advantage of the Anytone or the RT software that I like a lot compared to the factory programming software, the stuff you get from them, is that the RT systems lets you copy and paste and move things up and down in your memory list in big blocks, multiple lines all at one time. Easy to move things around, easy to copy and paste. You can even copy and paste lines from an Anytone radio over to an ICOM radio or a Kenwood radio. Not everything transfers, but a lot of things do. So that's cool. And none of that works in the factory software. It's one line at a time. If you want to move a line, you can move one line up and down. You got
do you use this?
That's the Bluetooth push to talk.
Yeah.
I've got one. I haven't actually used the Bluetooth push to talk, but I have listened to the radio and talked into the radio through my Jabra headset on Bluetooth. And the push to talk button, you could wrap it around your finger and make it easier to push to talk. My Jabra does not sound very good through it. It sounds pretty terrible. Anyway, the RT systems was more flexible, but when you go into the zone menu, unfortunately, all of that wonderfulness disappears. You can't cut and paste and copy and export and import anything about the zones, or I even think the scan lists, same thing, can't copy and paste and move them around. So in my case, and in David's case, we both have a mobile radio and a handheld that are almost clones of each other in terms of operation. And it would be nice to program one and then lift that program to the other one easily and make the radios in sync with each other, all the memory channels, all the zones, everything in sync. You can't exactly load the software from one to the other because the push buttons are all different. But all of the stuff within the radio channels and stuff could be the same. Unfortunately, with the RT system software, you can't do that. What I do is I program it with the RT. I read the radio with the factory CPS. The factory CPS lets you do an export from one radio, import it to the other, and then bring it in.
What I did.
Yeah. And you might say, well, that seems like an awful lot of extra work. But after I've spent an hour or so programming the radio, it takes about 5 or 10 minutes to go through that process.
Maybe by next week when we talk, I'll have updated the Bluetooth microphone that I got so I can put that radio.
Yeah. Did you get the Bluetooth mic?
I did.
A lot of people are having.
I found that the firmware in the radio that I got is two levels behind. So I have to update the firmware. I have to find the cable to do that.
Yeah.
I think it's just a regular micro USB. So I need to update that and then put it in there, and then it's going to go in my truck. And I'm going to remove that FTM-100 that I hate. Anybody wants an FTM-100, I'll sell it to you for only $300 cash money.
What does the FTM-100 do? Is it it's not a Fusion radio, right?
It is.
It is.
It's actually the first, it's like the first of the mobile Fusion radios.
Yes. Oh, we haven't done our FTM.
You want an Anytone, David? I'll trade you.
I like that radio. Oh, you want to trade the FTM-100 for that Anytone?
Sure.
I don't want to take advantage of you like that, Jim.
I like my TYT much better than this thing.
All right. If you don't like that radio, I don't like my radio. It would be a good trade.
Which TYT?
I was up there.
MD-380.
I actually didn't go that far.
Is that the dual band MD-380, the UV, or the mono band?
I would trade you that. You want a charger? I'll give you the charger. You know what I realized when my laptop bag got stolen out of my car in San Francisco and I thought it was my Anytone? It wasn't. It was my TYT. It was my MD-380. Pretty sure that's what I got.
This one's UHF only, and that's all I really cared about for doing DMR stuff.
Yeah, I picked up the UV-380, and it's got some interesting issues.
Got a red label on it.
Yeah, I put to distinguish it from my MD-380 UHF only, just also sitting over there. I put some labels on it so I could see. It's got a blue label, but the blue label is so dark you really can't see it. on the antenna, and I need to get a lighter one because I can't see it either. Anyway, the UV380 doesn't work like the original UHF only MD380 does. The MD380 has 16 channels per zone, and so the channel switch has a stop, physical stops on both ends, stops from 1 to 16. So this has 64 channels per zone, and so the knob goes round and round and round. There's no stop. But if you change zones, it jumps you back to channel 1. And then you go back to the previous zone, and you're back on channel 1. It doesn't remember what channel you were on the previous zone. That's a minor issue. It's a first world problem, but...
Yeah, I was going to say.
But if you want to, you know, jump back and forth between zones and get to the channel you were on, every other radio I've got that has banks or zones or anything else, you go from one zone to another, and you go back to where you left off. So that it doesn't do it that way. It also has a weird thing about using, and here's Jim's favorite tone code, digital tone code. When you use digital tone code and you finish transmitting, the digital tone code has a little bit of data that says, I'm done. And it closes the squelch on the receiving radio. That's not working, at least in my UV MD380. And I was on a local repeater and just testing things out. And I transmit and I let go, and big, long, honking squelch tail. And I picked up another couple of radios and I give them tests and, you know, transmit and let go. And at the end, you know, just beep, nothing, no squelch tail. It just pretty much goes to silence. Go back to the UV380 and big, long, honking squelch tail. The repeater that I was on, I don't think that they had carrier squelch set up. I think they were relying on the DCS end of transmission code to quiet things down. And when they didn't get it, it took a while for the repeater to say, I'm not getting any code at all. I guess I better quiet myself down. Mm. Another interesting thing about that, and this will show you how things have changed in ham radio with digital stuff. This is an analog repeater. A guy comes on and says, there's a bunch of data coming on the end of your transmission. What? Yeah, I'm hearing a big data burst on the end of your transmission. A data burst? You're hearing a squelch tail, dude. It's just a squelch tail. No, it's a data burst. So now people are so digital oriented that if you hear something that goes, psh, it's a data burst. But it was a squelch tail. He was slightly offended that I kept telling him it's not a data burst. Okay, one more thing. I was telling you guys about an antenna that I had gotten for, it's this top antenna, the Comet CA2X4SR. What are you showing me, David?
I don't know. I have my antenna here that isn't gone in the car either. This is going to be the one that's going to go. Oh, I'll shut up.
Yeah.
That's the one that goes along with the AnyTone that's going to go in my truck.
Well, I've got this one. The thing about this is they call it the wideband VHF, UHF.
Well, that's the one that has service. A little halo, like the little angular halo thing on
there. Yeah, it's got a little curly Q in the middle.
Yeah. Yeah. A little pigtail. Jimmy, yeah. Shake your comment on the curly Q. Come on. Say
it's,
it.
It's just inductance.
Say it.
Yeah.
It's just a trap.
Yeah. The thing about that antenna is it's broadband. And so I've stuck it on the car. The SWR looks good from practically DC to daylight. The SWR even looks good on 220 megahertz. And the AnyTone radio I've got it connected to does 5 watts on 220. So I'm going, well, it's not going to hurt the radio. I'm not getting a lot of power back.
You should have done this radio.
The radio.
This antenna.
What sorry, about it?
I'm again.
That's your, yeah, it's your tri-band?
This is the tri-band. It would cover all of them.
Right, but if you were to put that on a radio that you want to talk out on GMRS, not that I would talk out on GMRS on a ham radio. I'd always do an antenna switch and go over to a real GMRS radio. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Lies.
Yeah. Tell me lies. Tell me sweet little lies. So, not only is it the SWR coming back is fine, but the SWR coming back from a 50 ohm resistor would look good. So the question is, how well is it performing? And so I'm keying up some 220 repeaters around the area, and it just seems to be getting into 220 repeaters at some distance. So it's not going to be a great radiator on 220, but it's better than a wet noodle.
They don't even include any of the what it covers. It just says 2 meters, 1.25, 70 centimeters, and that's it.
Yeah. If you were to try to transmit through it at the top end of the repeater band on GMRS, which is 467.725, you would probably find the SWR well above 2-to-1, closing on 3-to-1.
No, that's all right.
Yeah. So probably don't want to use it.
GMRS people so much anyway.
But that's not the point that I wanted to make. The point that I wanted to make about this antenna was I had said on our previous show that it was not a foldover. And so I was I thought it was. And then when I got it, if you look in the bag, it doesn't say anything about being a foldover.
No, mine doesn't either. But when you take it out of the box.
Yeah. And
where's the antenna? Can you show us?
It's on the car.
It folds over, but it folds over.
Yeah, it does.
It does, right?
Yeah. So it does fold over. So I would put it on a magnet mount for a while thinking, I got to have something that I can easily knock it down. And then I was looking through this this little brochure that they sent me. And the antenna is in the brochure. It's this one here in the middle. And it says fold over. Yeah, it says fold over. Fold over hinge included. So sure enough, not very happy camper because now it can sit on one of the NMO mounts on the car. And I can reach up and fold it over and life is good.
I like the newer VHF ones that have a little nut on them to tighten them down.
Yeah, this one doesn't because it's not that real tall antenna. It just has a stiff spring.
It doesn't have the spring.
Yeah, but the taller ones have a weak spring, which means it's a lot easier to lift it up out of the mount and fold it over. But the weak spring would let the antenna lift up in the wind and fold over while you're driving, which is not an ideal situation. So they have a collar that comes down. In fact, this is just happen to have it sitting here. This is the way it works. This is the one that busted.
Reminds me, I had an SSB2 at some point. No, that's
not getting actually SBB, not SSB. I kept saying SSB myself.
SBB2. Yeah. And no, I had a 1, which was it's the rubber duck on a mount. And it was good, except for summertime on the freeway. It would be 115 degrees here in Woodland Hills. And you get on the freeway, it would soften it up and it would helicopter. And I couldn't understand why I kept hearing when I was driving on the freeway when it was hot. And at some point, one of my friends said, hey, you know, when you're on the freeway, there's an antenna on the back of your car and it's whipping around. It would smack the side of the truck.
So. Always helpful to have somebody give you a visual.
I don't have that. I don't have that anymore. I thought there was something else wrong with the car, but they couldn't figure it out.
You took it into the shop. The car is vibrating.
No, I did. Actually, I didn't because it didn't do anything for the driving. Unlike on the way to see Jim at Quartz Fest when the electrical tape unwound and was banging on the roof. And it was time to stop for gas anyways. I was going to go another 25 or 30 miles, but as it was doing the whatever it was doing, I stopped. And there was about a foot of electrical tape from my flashy light bars that was pounding on the roof. Hey, weren't we going to talk about Bouvet tonight?
Yeah, but I have one more thing. Uh-oh. I'm getting bad juju from Wirecast about
your bandwidth.
Yeah, it's going bad again.
Keep that.
YouTube. It's YouTube. It's not Facebook. Facebook is probably fine. 4K? Say again?
Just stop sending Facebook.
It doesn't make any difference because the problem is at YouTube.
Nobody there care, but you're taken away from the what you could feed them.
I have 600 megabits symmetrical.
All right.
Let me take a look here.
Yeah, YouTube is not happy.
Yeah, I have 600 megabits symmetrical data.
So should we say forget YouTube and we'll post it to Facebook?
I'll replace it on the YouTube.
There's one person watching us on Facebook.
But Facebook doesn't matter because Facebook is not the issue, and I've got plenty of bandwidth.
All right. Let me go to the Facebook's. Oh, yeah. YouTube's all screwed up.
Yeah. Oh. Here's my bandwidth. I'm sending. Always looks like it's all over the map, but the average is around 6 megabits.
Paul said she needs to come shock you. That's not good rhythm.
I'm out of sinus rhythm.
Yep.
So, yeah, I could stop YouTube and start it again.
Oh, did Jason go live? Did everybody leave the chat room to go watch somebody else?
Jason?
Jason or Josh or one of the guys.
Were they in our chat room?
There was 8 or 10 people in there, and now there's only 4 watching.
Well, yeah, because if it's all messed up.
It's all messed up. All right, well, I'm going to close the chat room. I'm going to close this. I posted in Facebook. Anybody out there? And nobody responded. Just good.
Let me take a look at take a look at the go live and see how bad it is.
Oh, we got voicemail. Oh. Sorry. I'll be quiet. We will talk about Bouvet, right?
We will be talking about Bouvet in a minute. Sunday? I got one more thing. I am going to drop the Facebook stream just for fun. But YouTube is telling me, connect your streaming software to go live. I'm connected, dude. I'm connected. It doesn't think I'm connected. Wants to schedule a stream.
You must have lost that connection. I closed it all.
Hey, let's see.
Marty Wall.
Okay, if you're watching on Facebook where the thing is good, I'm stopping Facebook. So, sorry. I may start it up again in a minute. See if it makes any difference. It's still showing yeller. Now it's showing red. Now it's showing nothing. So we may be talking to ourselves.
We have been talking to ourselves for almost an hour, Gary. Yeah.
Well, I'm recording.
Yeah, it's okay. And we'll post it. They'll share it.
Yeah. We'll show up in the middle of the night for everybody out there. Woohoo!
No indication from YouTube why that it's your outbound is failing or screwed up there?
Oh. Well, for one thing, I'm logged into the wrong account, so it's not going to show me anything. Let me log into the right account. I got like 45 YouTube accounts. And now it's going to show me what's going on. There we go.
Yeah, we're just spinning.
Yeah, YouTube is not receiving enough video to maintain a smooth stream.
All right, so we should move on. You're recording it. You can upload it later. That's how we used to do this anyways, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, so then the last thing I wanted to mention was I've been putting up a couple of TikToks. We have a Ham Radio Now TikTok channel, and I've been putting up a couple. What I did, it was from the balloon episode. Uh-huh. And I actually managed to edit that down to 1 minute.
Oh, great.
Do you want to see it?
I was going to look it up here. Glad it wasn't a thirst trap, Gary.
Let's take a look. This is what happens when you knock a, this is actually a YouTube short, because TikTok can take 10 minutes. But YouTube shorts can only be 1 minute, and it's got like almost 700 views. This is what it looks like. This is Ham Radio Now. Good. This is episode 463, The Chinese Balloon and Ham Radio. Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, directly under the flight path.
David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC.
Bill Brown, WBADLK, The Balloon Guy. Todd McKinney, KN4TPG.
My background is in atmospheric science, looking at balloon trajectories.
The only thing the news has been able to talk about is this Chinese surveillance balloon.
If you want to loiter across the United States as slow as possible to gather data, between 58 and 65,000 feet would be where you want to be this time of year, because that's the minimum winds. And I believe you could predict the right time to launch it to go across the United States, even from the other side of the world.
We think it's that device to collect what signals are we bouncing off the balloon to track it.
Over.
And?
Let me guess. Out.
Perfect. This, and then it repeats because they want you to watch it over and over again. It automatically repeats. It's relentless.
No, that's just the formula.
Yeah. It's the way it works. Anyway, yay. We're getting some... I dropped the Facebook, and it doesn't matter. YouTube's still saying
too slow.
Not enough data.
All right. Well, I'm going to try to step my game up in the coming weeks, and I can start hosting because I have a good connection to the internet, unlike the...
I have a damn good connection to the internet.
No, you're in a retirement community. They're just gaslighting you.
It's Facebook.
They're telling you have a good connection, but maybe you don't.
It's Facebook. I mean, it's YouTube. YouTube is ignoring me.
Okay, what is wrong with this? This is wrong. It's been bugging me for the last, like, 3 episodes.
What?
Taking the battery out.
Wrong time? Wrong temperature?
Yeah, the time's out.
Fix it.
I don't know how to fix it. It's all like, electronic satellite. It's the Chinese spy satellite thing. Balloons are messing me up. Hey, so what happened with Bouvet, Gary?
Oh, if we're going to talk about Bouvet, then what we need to do is start the show. And in order to start the show...
So is this a promo to talk about it on Sunday when we have more info, or we're going to do it all now?
No, we're going to do the show now. And
Sunday?
And then, I don't know.
Squirrel?
Something else. We'll do something else on Sunday.
Love
but
that.
It's time to start the show. To start the show, we need the music. This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. A Bouvet Valentine. Episode 465. February 14th.
Wait.
2023.
I don't believe that episode number.
465?
I don't think so.
You don't think the last show was 464?
I could be wrong. All right, you're right. Go ahead.
Moving right. Okay, I'm right. A Bouvet Valentine. Let's see. Jim, you get to be the first person identified.
Live from the base of Mount Ammonim in the Evil Genius Lair, Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC.
And from the garage below my parents' house along Mulholland Drive at the base of Topanga Canyon in beautiful Los Angeles, California, I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And from the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, in the shadow of Charlotte, in the foot of Mount Bolzoni, and directly under the flight path of the Chinese spy balloon, I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. Takes care of that business. So, Bouvet is done. Remember the show we did on Bouvet?
I do.
The guy's name was Adrian, was that it?
We did more than one show on Bouvet.
Yeah, we did.
I remember the recent one.
Well, we did one with one of the guys that went there.
Yeah.
Before he went there.
There was a previous one, wasn't there? But they didn't make it. The one that had engine failure and they got close and there was two.
Yeah, that was a couple years ago. Yeah, it was a few years ago. Yeah,
but that was another Bouvet show.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We did that a long time ago.
Bouvet show.
Yeah. The current Bouvet.
Yeah, sorry.
We did... And talked to, I think his name was Adrian, I think. And he talked about what they were planning, all the stuff that they had been preparing. They were going to be on the island for 3 weeks mm-hmm. with kilowatt stations, big antennas, multiple stations, It was all going to be wonderful, and they were going by sailboat, and everyone I'd say that they were going to this sub-Antarctic island by sailboat, people go, by sailboat?
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah, that's what I all said. Mm-hmm. It was a good hook, and they went, and the sailboat got them there, and just, the boat mm-hmm. is fine. The folks that didn't make it, they had a ship failure. They also might have had trouble getting on and off the island. They were planning on getting on and off using a couple of little helicopters.
Right.
That could have been a little dicey mm-hmm. and, because of weather.
Yep.
But they had a ship failure, an engine failure, two engines on the ship. One of them, the coupling burned out. Turns out that the ship had been totally refitted before taking these guys to Bouvet. And one of the engines was canted a degree or something. Just a little bit, and they had a flexible coupling. I don't think it was rubber necessarily, but it was a flexible coupling, and that coupling started to smoke. So they took it out and replaced it with a previous coupling, an older one, but the captain on the ship thought, this is not good. We're barely holding our position into the wind with both engines running, and you know, anchoring.
Nobody needs to die for a bunch of QSOs.
No.
From North America.
So, Europe. So that one was a fail. Yep. These guys got there on the sailboat. The weather was bad.
No, they got to several hundred yards out on the sailboat.
Well, they were never going to go any closer on the sailboat.
Okay.
They were not going to try to dock the sailboat. There's no marina.
Yeah, but they were going to Zodiac in.
Right. Which they did. But even the Zodiac couldn't land
right
on the beach. They ended up jumping out of the Zodiac in their environment suits and carting what meager equipment they could, one tent, a couple of Honda generators instead of their big diesel generators, no amplifiers, a couple of limited antennas, and getting that on. And they've been operating for about a week, maybe a little bit more. Mostly 30 meters, a little bit of 17 meters, some CW, a lot of FT8, and almost no sideband. And maybe one day they made it on 20 meters for a little bit. And Jim, you tried listening for him. You never got him.
Yeah, I never heard anything. I saw people trying to chase him on FT8, and I never saw any responses back.
Yeah. So... I mean, they did make contacts. I don't know how many, what the total is yet, but it was nowhere near what they were anticipating had they been able to do the full operation. It's going to be a big deal. They made the full operation. So they didn't. And the weather was going to get bad again. And so they made the decision that they were never going to get everything on the island that they wanted to, all the people, all the equipment, all the antennas, that wasn't going to happen. And so they decided to pull the plug. And so they are all back on the ship now and probably about ready, or maybe they've already departed. They are going to head back to Cape Town, South Africa, because that's the way the winds blow them. They're on a sailboat. And I'm sure much more of the story will be coming out. I don't know how much more they're going to get out. Well, they're on the ship coming back. They do have connectivity on the ship. They have Starlink connectivity. Mm-hmm. And so they might have some ability to make some contacts via internet. They'll get more because they sent some pictures out and stuff. I don't know if we'll be able to get them like on a show.
Yeah.
Live from the boat. That would be really cool.
Yeah, the Facebook they've been posting, if they have Starlink, we should be able to do episode number 467 or whatever it is.
Yeah. I don't think we're high on their list.
No, I don't think we are either.
This is one of those things in the ham radio media world, everybody is going to be pounding on those guys for the interview.
Mm-hmm.
And
we're not the 800-pound gorilla, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, well,
combined, maybe, but
hey.
They can go talk to Josh and get 100,000 people, and they can come to us and get the other 250.
Yeah,
that missed it on Crash Course and Ham Nation and all that stuff. we'll be in the mix, but probably not till they get back home. And they'll have some, I'm sure, very interesting stories to tell about what went on. So what I've got is just from their website, something any or their Facebook group, something anybody can get. They have, now that they're back on the ship, they have posted a bunch of pictures. That's what their environment suits look like. That's what they jumped in the water 30 feet out from the shore to haul their equipment in. That's what they were wearing when they
Those suits are made for if the boat's going down and you need to go in the water waiting for somebody to come rescue them. That's what those suits are made for.
Yeah. So they were good. There's a bunch of shots in the one tent that they've got set up, and there'll be a picture coming up that shows the one tent and some of the antennas. So they're just, you know, kind of clunked the equipment together best they could. It looks like actually two stations, one facing one way and one facing the other way. Using what space they've got. No amplifiers, so they're stuck at a maximum of 100 watts and probably a little bit less on FT8.
Yeah, FT8 didn't need more than that, though.
Yeah. The frequency I'm reading is 18.0769, so the bottom end of 30 meters. Mm-hmm. And that's where most of the DX spots that I saw were showing them operating, mostly on 30 meters.
17.
Oh, I take it back. That's 17 meters. Yeah, it showed a lot of 17-meter FT8 and some CW. I have heard, you know, again, reading their Facebook post, there was no heat, so it was cold in there. So they're all still pretty much bundled up.
But there's a tent stove right there.
There's a heater there.
Yeah, but they couldn't run it all the time because
they didn't have anything to put in it?
Didn't have enough fuel for it, as I understand. Okay. Although, you know, jackets hung up there. You know, maybe it's not quite so
probably bad. Illegal to cook the penguins on the island.
Yeah. Like that. Okay, so there's the one tent that they've got set up and a couple of verticals.
All right. These guys failed field day 101.
In what way?
Well, you know, they got the one vertical. I'm just kidding.
Okay.
I'm really impressed that they, given all the challenges of getting there in those conditions, that they actually went for it.
That they had to swim in?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And that they did it.
I'm not sure I would have done that. We did it in Florida with the scouts, but it was like 85 or 90 degrees. And we had to go a quarter. We had to go a quarter of a mile.
Now, did you do that just to try it or because you had to?
No, we spent 2 days on that island that they dumped us off on.
But you had to swim in or wade in?
Yeah, wade in mostly.
Okay.
Because you around the bull sharks.
Yeah. There's the backup crew. There's the penguins.
Ah.
So the pictures that they've got, the weather is not looking horrible, but I think that they took some pictures during the best weather. Because for the most part, it wasn't, I mean, you look at a picture like this and you say, well, why couldn't they get everybody in?
Well, because they probably weren't out there taking pictures when it was like windy, raining, yeah, and blowing 80 miles an hour.
Yeah. Yeah. When they were talking 3 meter swells, that was a little serious.
Yeah. And you know, but all the ham radio community locally, they were all like, hey, sorry, you guys didn't make it work out and we'll be there for you next time. Right.
Yeah. Right. That's the thing. The ham radio community showed their ass big time. You can see the ship out there on the.
Did you complain, Jim?
Horizon.
You know, the only thing, I mean, since I didn't hear a whole lot of traffic, I couldn't tell. You know, since I wasn't listening voice and I wasn't listening CW.
Well, back a shot, Gary, and wait for Jim to stop talking.
I was trying to, you know, read through it for just see what FT8 was doing, and but I did see some of the chatter on Facebook and other groups that you know. They had gone QRT and other people were trying to answer as Bouvet on FT8 in the wrong modes and all this kind of stuff. I mean, there's all kinds of horrible garbage out there. All the pirates trying to
just like when North Korea comes on the air.
Yeah, bootleggers, people bootlegging their call sign. I never heard them, but I did listen from my mobile on several occasions, listening on 30 meters and on 17 meters. And I heard a lot of jamming. People It's just basically on CW call and CQ right on top of their frequency, quite deliberately. No call sign, just do for minutes and minutes on end. The ham radio do-it-yourself police were there because there were plenty of operators who don't understand operating split. And so they were calling the Bouvet station on the Bouvet station's frequency. And there were a lot of people that were coming on. Now, this is on Morse code, and it's a little difficult to give detailed instructions with a finger wag on Morse code.
I think when they posted their operating schedule, it probably would have helped them a lot to say, okay, you know, ahead of time, this is what fox and hound mode means in FT8, and this is how you set up for it. And when we say we're operating up, you know, does every ham know it's up 5, or is it up 10, or is it up 30? And they could have been very explicit and you know, done a little better job of real-time spotting where people could actually find them.
Yeah. Well, if you look at a big DXpedition like this, up 5 means that may be the beginning of where the pileup ought to start. But the pileup is going to be 10 kilohertz wide on CW and 30 kilohertz wide on phone if they ever got on phone. I don't know how the FT8 works in terms of spreading signals out. Do you even bother?
Oh, yeah. Well, you no, pick...
It's channelized. Sorry, go ahead, Jim.
Well, you have... It, I don't know how it decides or you select how many hertz off of carrier frequency your data is going to appear versus what you're listening to. You know, I just let the flex sort it out, but I could definitely tell that, I think you're on the same frequency. You're just listening on a different part of the frequency in the audio bandwidth or whatever data was coming across. So some things I need to figure out, you know, learn about how FT8 works.
Yeah, and apparently a lot of people did. And I saw a lot of comments that were saying that the Bouvet guys had their fox and hound settings set wrong. And I know the name, you know, the name fox and hound for it, but I have no idea how it gets set up. So people were complaining that they were doing it wrong from the island, and I don't know if those complaints were accurate or not. Let's take a look at a few more pictures here. Was this a picture you wanted to say something about, David?
I want to see.
Even know what I'm looking at here. Landmine.
It's snowed in gear is what I assume I see. But who knows?
Yeah. It doesn't look like it snowed feet while they were there, but no. Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, but enough to cover your stuff. Yeah. That doesn't look hospitable.
No. They got the door open. It can't be that cold.
No, but you know, I bet they didn't have the door open for long.
Yeah.
But I'm sure there was somebody in there going, close the door.
Yeah. And mostly sitting on the ground or on it a little bit of covering, but no chairs, no tables.
Well, Gary, they swam in.
Yeah. They didn't swim a table in. Didn't swim a chair in.
Yeah. And the tent and the gear and the antennas and the whatever. And yeah, I made fun
and
of
food,
but all of that stuff they swam in.
Yeah. And their food. So there's a pretty picture. The night shot. People may be able to see us on YouTube. No, I was going to say YouTube went yellow, then it went red, and then it went black, went bad.
I stopped watching YouTube.
Yeah. We're talking to ourselves right now, but I'll post it right away.
You're going to post it up. People will watch it later on.
Yeah. A lot of laptops.
Yeah, well, they're doing a lot of FT8. That means a lot of laptops.
Well, and logging. You know, everything's going to be logged.
Yeah.
Laptop-ish.
Yeah, there are complaints of logs. When are you going to update the logs? We're going to upload the logs and all that. It's when we get back to the ship and you know, maybe have some bandwidth.
Yeah. So I guess, you know, the next question is why. I don't know what percentage of the hams out there were being assholes. Probably a small percentage, but they're noisy. And especially, you know, if they're doing jamming and stuff on the air, they really show up. If you looked at comments that were made on some of the DX spots, there were a lot of bad comments from people that just giving these guys no break. So
it wasn't called for. I mean, you know, I can imagine the people who donated a lot of money to, you know, have put all that money into that trip and gotten a week's worth of operation on two bands, you know, they're probably not too happy about it, but the guys are alive. And this is something that, you know, most people, you know, won't even go out on winter field day. And this was the epitome of a winter field day. So, you know, show the guys a little slack and have a little respect for whatever. But I still think, both, you know, the DXpedition could have done a little better, you know, a one page cheat sheet of how to how to work us. And I know we had some, primer about that, you know, in other shows, but just a one pager that says, this is how you ought to set up your stuff. Flex could have done that. ICOM could have done one. Here's how to make sure your 7300 is ready to work Bouvet. And so I'm sure a lot of people like me were scrambling to figure out what some of this stuff meant as a first time trying that mode.
Shouldn't some of that be on you to figure out how to operate your equipment? Should it be
a
tutorial from the DXpedition?
When we had them on before they left, they talked about they had gotten together a couple times and got their gear out and practiced. That's what I think that they said.
They need to know how to run their gear, but
I'm talking about myself. I would have loved to, you know, it would have been easy. I could have done up 30 on sideband, no problem. But, you know, I didn't learn until the day they landed. Oh, well, we're going to be operating Fox and Hound mode. Okay, now I got to go through, set up my, you know, make sure my flex is set up to do it. Make sure I understand what this is. In the middle of all that, my flex software took a dump. So I had to go reload all that, you know, lost 4 hours of an operating day, you know, getting the rig set back up. And I said, okay, well, they're obviously gone. And plus, you know, not knowing where all the spot locations were, trusting Facebook's 6-hour delay and posting things that, oh, well, they were on the air 8 hours ago. I guess they're not there now. So, yeah, I mean, you know, I never claimed to be a big DXpedition DX operator and all that, but I'm thinking if you want to, if you're selling this thing and you want to optimize the time for people to go, oh, well, here's a reason to go turn on my HF rig. We could have, maybe we'll think about that next time as an operating guide.
Yeah, it sounds like they had planned to be there longer and it just for.
Yeah, well, they were going to be on for another couple of weeks.
Yeah, they're on for a couple of weeks. So, you know, things go not as planned. I, you know, 2 weeks from now, I didn't expect I'd be working from home for the last 3 years. Just say it.
Yeah. Yeah, this was close to worst case scenario. Worst case, of course, would have been that they didn't get on the island at all. But they're pretty close. When we were talking to them on the show, they were describing the best case scenario, which was, again, 3 weeks, multiple stations, their big diesel generators, kilowatt amps, multi-mode, all the modes. They weren't even talking about that much FT8. I think they went to FT8 because that's the weak signal mode, and that was what most people would actually be able to make a contact with.
No, I think when they talked to us, they were talking about they were going to do all of that.
Yeah, but they weren't emphasizing FT8. And I think it turns out most of their stuff seemed to be FT8 and some CW. So yeah. It's too bad. But my big disappointment, I didn't send them money. So, you know, maybe if I had sent them a couple hundred bucks and was kind of hoping to get them on all bands and up my DXCC certificates and stuff to start pushing myself up to the somewhere in the stratosphere of the DXCC lists, I'd be really frustrated and really upset. I'll bet those guys, though, the guys that are way up near the top of the lists that still need a Bouvet, I bet they understand.
I can imagine if you're frustrated and annoyed because you gave the money and hoping to help support them getting there. They did get there. Didn't work out as well as they wanted to. I don't know.
Well, I'm sure they're not checking the donor list going, wait a minute. Have we hit the $10,000 guys yet?
There's a dupe in the log. We put all the donors in. I think your point about they're all alive and headed home.
It's probably a
you know, bad commentary on what's going on in our world.
I think what it says is that a place that has risen to the top of the most needed list rises there for a reason. It is really hard to get there.
Yeah.
Really hard to set up that kind of an operation. And the best I can tell, they did everything that they could right. And the world conspired against them.
And, you know, they knew how to sail in there, and they got there without issue. So, you know, that's fine. Sometimes you don't always prepare your own station operation for something that may happen 3 or 6 months, or, you know, are you even going to care and try to work it or not? So, you know, while I complain, I couldn't find some easy tips of what I was supposed to be doing. Yes, I could have studied a little bit harder ahead of time. Well, now I know what I have to go back and learn. So I'm not disappointed I didn't work them at all. But knowing when and where they were going to be, that was a hard thing to find. My inability to make contact or operate my gear is my problem, not theirs.
Yeah. And I'm also, none of us are big time DXers. I'm going through the DX spotting websites with very little background on how they work, and saying, I'm not seeing a lot of spots for 3Y0J, and, you know, maybe they're not getting spotted that much. Everything seemed to be a little bit old. Then I discovered that they would get on Facebook and I could find out what frequencies they were on within a few minutes. If I went and looked for it, they started updating their Facebook page, with what frequencies they're going to be operating on.
Yeah. Well, from a spotting perspective, they did, I don't know what the percent of what they expected to do. If they did 10% of what they expected to do, obviously a lot less spotting would go on. Because, you know, when we talk to them, hey, we're going to be on this band and that band and the other band and this band, and we're going to do this mode and that mode and the other mode, and we're going to have, you know, all these operators here. And I think that's when they thought, hey, we'll just pull up the boat and the Zodiacs will land on the shore and we'll pull all this stuff off. And there wasn't any of the whole idea of like, yes, now we're going to swim 200 yards in the water in environmental suits and float stuff into the bay.
Yeah.
But, you know, cut them some slack, people. And I don't know, I didn't see a whole lot of this, but I know, Gary, you said that there were people out there not only complaining about it, but spoofing the calls and not responding and all that. And, you know, shame on you.
Just about every bad thing you can think of to do, there are hams out there doing it.
Yeah.
I've heard people say, well, you know, the problem is it's all those no code extras that are doing it. I'll bet the guys who are being the biggest butts can operate 30 words a minute. I'm going to speculate that
they didn't get their contact.
I'm going to speculate that on the basis of absolutely no information whatsoever, just because I got the bile.
Yeah.
But, Riley Hollingsworth made that comment in an FCC forum. He said, you know, people tell me that the problems of ham radio are all because of the no codes. He says that the guys that I'm going after have had extras for 20 or 30 years. They're my problem children.
They're the bad actors.
Yeah.
What's your experience up there, Jim? Is that the way it goes?
Well, I don't know. I don't think we have any particular outstanding class or category of problem users up here. I mean, there are probably problem users, but I couldn't say who they are.
Well, the idea that you're going to complain about the no codes, that just comes from your complaint about no code, not from knowing anything about the no codes. It's just because you don't like the idea of no codes, so you're going to blame the bad things on the no codes.
Yeah. Been there, done that.
Correlation is not causation. And
I shake my head and I walk away from those people. That's what it is.
Yeah. Post hoc, ergo propter hoc. I think I got that.
Well, like Riley said, just spin the big dial.
Turn the big
knob. You know,
I hope in a month or two or a little bit more after that we can get them on and hear all of the tales of the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
Because, you know, here's the thing. For all the people that complained and acted bad, these guys tried more than I did. I just stayed here in Woodland Hills with 38 degrees.
Why is it so cold? You're in Los Angeles.
It's cold. We're in the cold part of Los Angeles.
No, we just had a bunch of wind blow through from someplace.
It's
our turn to get cold.
Yeah, with the wind, it seems colder. But they did it. They tried. And, you know, I guess stepping back, I can't imagine why people would be complaining about all that. But I can.
Yeah, my internet must be really messed up because, David, you're like way out of sync.
I'm out of sync.
Yeah. Their audio is like way behind.
Well, the next question about this is if they spent all the money or they've got some change in the bank, what will it take for them to go back and when? Because it was a couple of years since they've been there. It takes a lot of stuff. And I suspect some of these guys are going, well, my wife said I had one shot to go to this icy place and work radio, and that was it. So I'm not going back.
But
how that's going to work.
I think the expedition that was a couple of years ago isn't a totally different group, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to see something about my internet? There's my speed test.
Oh, it's not your problem. Let's see if it's mine. Let me do mine. Is that
Well, there's speed and there's latency, so there's two factors.
Yep. Let's see what mine says.
Now, that was testing. I'm on Comporium Internet, and that was testing to their site, which is as good as it gets.
Can you see my screen? I'm not sharing. Oh, I got to go to this. Look at that.
You had 871 down?
Well, it's down. I don't usually get that kind of performance.
Are you on cable or are you on fiber?
Cable. We pay for a gig cable. We pay for a gig down and 40 up. So actually, I'm in better shape than I've been in a long time. Let's see. Let's try it one more time. Where's the do this again? We'll go back. Try it one more time. Let's see. And then Jim, you're next.
Jim's signal's fine. I'm not going to
share my screen.
He's like, I got good internet. I don't know what you guys are complaining about.
Jim's signal's fine.
No, I'm doing good.
326 down.
This PC is hardwired, which is, you know.
Are you on Wi-Fi?
What?
Are you on Wi-Fi?
No, I'm.
You don't want to be on Wi-Fi.
No, I don't want to be on Wi-Fi. Are you kidding? No, hardwired. I get gigabit to the switch.
Okay.
I'm going to put some mesh TP-Link stuff, but that's like for, you know, the bedrooms and the kids' rooms and whatever and the laptops.
Yeah, fine for that. They're not doing podcasts.
Yeah. No, this is, I think where I am is pretty good. It is. It's not me, man. It's not me.
It's interesting. Usually I don't get.
Here, we'll do the.
When you do a share screen, usually I still get your picture on one of my monitors. But
yeah,
losing you entirely. Well,
because I'm using the Wirecast camera. When I did the share screen.
Oh, okay. You wasn't doing a share screen. You were just switching Wirecast.
Yeah,
I understand
that. Like, I just show you all the junk here on my desk.
Yeah.
Or I could show you the screen that I have almost set up or the screen over there. Whatever.
It's all very confusing.
I like this camera. This is the new camera. We're working on this for later. Do
you see me? That's your demo camera?
Yeah. I'm working on the bench camera.
Yep. All right. Well, I think we're done complaining about hams.
Oh,
very disappointing, you ham radio operators out there.
Yeah, what we should say is thanks. Thanks for trying, Bouvet, folks.
Yeah. I do want to tell people that if you want to see another rant about bad operating, go up to Josh, the Ham Radio Crash Course. 7.9 thousand views 10 hours ago. He did this earlier today. Let me see if I update, if he's gotten up to 100,000 views. Okay, be quiet. Yeah, he's coming up on 10,000 views. So he'll get 10,000 views for his rant about bad hams. And we will fill in with another 250 or so. So go over to the Crash Course. And he's got a pretty good show on what hams were doing. There's recordings out there of the hams being butts. I didn't go scarf them up. He shows more of the lines of the spotter, the X clusters, spotter websites, where people are making their comments. Idiots.
Well, what I want to know is, what about good hams that are like in Turkey or other stuff like that? I know we won't have that for Sunday, but.
Yeah, I don't know what we're going to do on Sunday. It's only, what's today? Monday, right?
Sunday. Today is Tuesday.
Today is Tuesday.
Today is Tuesday? Happy Valentine's.
I lost today. Today's Tuesday. Damn it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody. Did you do stuff with your Valentine's, your respective Valentine's out there?
Are you?
Nothing special. No. It wasn't one of those days.
Stay away from restaurants.
Yeah. Well, that we've learned that years ago.
Yep. Take them out Monday night, the night before.
Yeah. The night before and the night after. And yeah.
Yeah. We're not big on that holiday stuff, especially the Valentine. Is Valentine's a Hallmark holiday or is it?
Yep.
Purely a Hallmark
holiday. I think there was a Saint Valentine, but yeah, I think Hallmark. I did my Hallmark stuff yesterday, and the flowers and the card and the See's candy and the, you know.
Yeah, go get your candy tonight. Half off.
No, that's tomorrow.
I was at the Harris Teeter, our local grocery store. No, it's all marked down and the shelves are almost bare.
Already?
Yeah, they wanted to get it cleared out. I didn't get Cindy flowers this year. In the past, when she was working at a company, I would have the flowers sent over, and usually I would do it a days ahead of time. The flower shop loved the idea that I would come in and have them deliver not on the 14th, but on the 12th or the 10th or something, depending on what part of the week it fell in. And then they would be delivered. She worked in a 10-story building, you know, big, it was all one company. The company was NetApp. And in their RTP, Raleigh-Durham area offices, you know, there are like thousands of employees. And the flowers would be delivered to the reception desk downstairs, and they would call her up and say, you've got something to pick up. And she would get to go down there and pick them up and do what we call the flower walk all the way back to her cube with everybody, but mostly the women going, ooh, you got a guy. He's a keeper. And the guys would go, I forgot to order flowers.
Yeah, thanks for the reminder.
You know, if you did it 2 or 3 days ahead of time, you were the one that saved all.
Oh, yeah, saved their butts.
You saved all their asses because they were like, oh, we got to order flowers.
Yep.
Oh, is that this week? Oh, darn. I guess I got to cancel the guys and, you know, playing cards and playing poker and cigars.
Yep.
All right.
So let's see. The last thing I got to mention was that I lost the hammer. I can't find it. It's on the desk here someplace. But fortunately, this leftover stud from the broken.
Oh, you're kidding me.
The broken Comet antenna works just fine.
Works good enough.
Close enough.
All right.
Go back and listen to a previous program where I played it, see if the tone is any different. I think it's just fine. Alrighty, let me stick the long version of the music in here. Just let it play for a while. We've been doing this here show
for more.
Yeah. Didn't want to push all those buttons. Episode 465, Valentine's Day, February 14th, 2023. A Bouvet Valentine from us to them. Good job, guys. Did the best under bad circumstances, and we apologize for the rest of the hams out there who did not treat you well. And let's see, working in backwards order, I'm Gary Pierce, K4AQ, the King of Ham.
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHC.
Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC.
I got to wait for the music to find its way to the end. There we go. Over and out. No, over. I panicked.
Panicked.
I pushed the button too soon, and I got
all right, we have to go back a half an hour and start the whole thing over again.
Yeah, we're starting back over again. Over
and
out.
And you guys heard the boom there, right? That time, right? You heard it go boom?
I heard it click.
Yeah.
Is it a boom or a click?
It's both. It's a boom and a click. Wait, I'll run this again. This comes down, it lands with a boom. And then
lands with a twang and a whoosh.
And this is the old time TV thing.
And then there's a bang.
Yeah, you recognize what that is, right?
Is that the old clapper sign?
No, it's the what a TV used to look like, an old CRT TV.
Well, yeah.
When
it shrinks, yeah.
Yeah. When you turn off the TV back
right
40 years ago.
I was wondering about the sound.
Yeah.
Is that you turning off the knob?
The click is turning off the knob, but then I also put in the crackle that you got off of the CRT screen as things were decompressing. So all of that just for you, the Ham Radio Now audience. David, where'd you go? David's done. David signed off. WTF, David. David signed off.
All righty. Well, I got to go take care of some things.
All right. I'll go repost this up onto the YouTubes and see if I can make it work.
All right.
Now we're green. Now we're green. Now we're golden. The signal is good on YouTube. Now. And you know what the difference is? The difference is David signed off. I think this is also a correlation, is not causation, but David.
Well, was he logged on with Wirecast trying to like he was going to do the feed?
No, I don't think so. No.
Okay.
I don't know why. I don't know why that suddenly it's good. I'm going to leave the stream up for a minute and just go take a look at it, but I will let you go.
All righty, sir. See you later.
See ya. Bye-bye. Okay, so what's going on with this stream? Let me the stream still says poor. Wirecast giving me a green light, but the stream says poor. Now the stream says no data. Not receiving enough data. Oh, now I'm starting to see the chat. I wasn't really watching the chat. So, yeah, lots of comments about this stuff. Stream health, poor. The stream's current bit rate, 4919 for almost 5 kilobits per second, 5 megabits per second, is higher than recommended. We recommend you use a stream bitrate of 2500 kilobits per second. That's what it's saying here, right down here. Alrighty then, I will knock it down. All of your specs say 4 megabits is what you want for a 720p30 stream, which is what I'm sending you. And in theory, that's what I had set. I don't know why it's gone higher. But but I will set it to a little bit lower and see if that solves the problem out there in the future. Okay, you guys. How did this guy get out of position? I thought I had him set into the right spot. I thought I had him set right on a monitor. Let me fix him. Gonna fix ya. Too far. Close enough. Okay, well, I'll go take the live stream, bad live stream down from YouTube, Facebook. That's better. And go upload and do the audio and the website and other stuff. And see you guys Sunday night when we don't know what we're going to do, but we're going to do something. I'm sure we're going to do something. Bye, y'all.